Christmas. God bless you. Hello, I'm Pastor Vince Schott, and I am privileged and honored to be the senior pastor of Glad Tidings Church right here in beautiful Vancouver. And we want to wish you a Merry Christmas on behalf of all the staff, the trustees, the leaders of Glad Tidings Church. Merry Christmas. We're going to have a very special service. You're going to be blessed. Jesus is going to be exalted, and we're going to have a phenomenal time. God bless you.
Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad, próspero año y felicidad. Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad, Feliz Navidad, próspero año y felicidad. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Feliz Navidad. Prospero año y felicidad. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas. I wanna wish you a Merry Christmas from the bottom of my heart.
It's a great joy to worship the Lord and to give Him honor and to give Him glory today as we are so close to that wonderful Christmas time. We think of the goodness of God and the love of God for all of us. And I remember so well the scripture that says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." God so loved that He gave. It was love that made Him give. And you know, that love comes so clearly as we remember Christmas every year, because it's a time of giving, a time of caring, a time of sharing the love and the goodness that God has given. God loved so much, He gave all. He gave Jesus to come to the earth, to die, to be our Savior. No wonder the angels sang it as the shepherds were in the fields, and they said, "Glory to God in the highest, for He comes to bring us great tidings of wonderful joy, which shall be to all people." Aren't you glad that it's for everyone? This wonderful gift of Jesus Christ and His salvation is available to all. Whosoever will may come, the Bible says. And that includes you. That includes everyone. Thank the Lord. The Bible also says we love Him because He first loved us. And when Jesus came, He gave it all, even to His life on the cross. He gave that we might have that wonderful gift of salvation, that gift that just keeps giving and giving, giving people that believe and come to Christ peace and joy and victory and all the good things of God. And so what a wonderful opportunity we have just now to just give a little to the Lord. Because we love to give what God has given unto us. We want to do it joyfully and happily. And you know, we can never pay the price of salvation. That took the blood of Jesus Christ. But we can give into the house of God so there can be meat in his house, so there can be provision in his house, that others may know this wonderful gospel and may have the joy that Christmas brings, the joy that Jesus brings into hearts and lives. And so we encourage you this morning to give as unto the Lord, and we know God will richly bless you. Now you have different opportunities that will help you so you can give. You can drop by the church and give if you wish. You can give online. You can give through the e-transfer and the GT website. But as we give, let's give with joy, because the Bible says God loves a cheerful giver, and we want to express to God our appreciation and the joy that it brings us to know that Jesus Christ is still the same today. And he is still that gift that will keep giving peace and joy and victory and every good thing to all those who call on the name of the Lord. May the Lord richly bless you. I wish you a very happy, merry Christmas and a prosperous and blessed new year. God bless you all.
I have a son at last. His name is Jesus. He is a very special baby, given to the world and by passing into it through the circle of my arms. Sometimes when I look at him, he seems so little, so defenseless. When I wonder at the majesty of such a little soul, I am overwhelmed. I stand in awe before this infant majesty. Who could fathom this wonder? Why God, the Almighty One, would reduce himself to utter helplessness? I thrill to think that he, who is the very image of God himself, cannot even move unless I carry him. I often gaze upon him while he sleeps. I look and I shudder each time I realize that he is God's son. The long-awaited Messiah with a local dusty address living here in Bethlehem with me and Joseph. He seems so ordinary, so much like every other little baby I have known, that I often must stop to remember that it is so much more than others could even imagine him to be. Here, there is the majesty of splendor, that I have a baby, yet am chaste. Mother, I knew the word ahead of time, before I knew the word wife. Such was the miracle. God folded himself into a tiny form, and there within myself, the vast creator defined himself in a simple three-letter word, boy. I love God, and I've always desired to please him. And I see myself as no hero of Israel, and yet this great honor came to me. God made me a door and made his entrance into time through my poor body. Some doubt the miracle by asking how. How is a foolish question if God is truly God? How is really a kind of blasphemy by which weak mortals define that God must explain himself to the unbelieving? My question was not how. But why? No, really, why me? Grace is the only answer. Grace is a stubborn, lovely flower that picks the harshest desert in which to bloom. So heaven came to me, bringing gifts too real to doubt, too wonderful to explain. God flesh wrapped in splendor, who like the midday sun, too intense to stare at, lest the overwhelming blitz blind the eye. I must start in the beginning. In the 14th year of the Emperor Augustus, near twilight, on that insignificant day of that insignificant year, I was alone in the dark in the confining sitting room of my house in Nazareth. I was just sitting there, meditating on the Messiah. Like nearly all the Jews I know, I was rather eager that he should come. Oh, how we Jews needed God to show up. We were downcast. We doubted the hope that we needed to live. We told ourselves so often in our little synagogues that God had forgotten his people. You see, it is hard to believe that God would come in time to save Israel before the Romans destroyed it. And those Romans, oh, how tired we were of their swaggering arrogance. Meditating on the suffering of Israel, I breathed half aloud, "Lord, this would be a good time for you to send your Messiah. When will you save your people?" "Greetings," said a loud voice behind me. I spun around in the half light of the darkening room, and there stood a man I had never seen. And the aura of the light swept the ceiling above his head, and my breath stopped. "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." I was terrified. I begged my mind to tell me who this being really was and why had he come to my house and what had he meant by that odd phrase, "You who are highly favored." I felt much too small to respond to such an imposing visitor, and my words were nearly paralyzed as my body trembled. The awesomeness of the moment was almost more than I could bear. "Don't be afraid," said the angel. Gabriel went on, "Mary, you have found favor with God. You will have a child, and you will give birth to a son. And you are to give him the name Jesus, and he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign in the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." Well, at last, I spoke as one coming out of a stupor. How can this happen since I am a virgin? I learned that evening that God could explain himself to human beings. He would be less than a God that these human beings needed. "The Holy Spirit will come upon you," he said, "and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One that is to be born from you will be called the Son of God." Gabriel paused. He knew I needed time to sort through this shift of mysteries and to set his words in order. "Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her own age, and she who is said to be barren is already in her sixth month, for nothing is impossible with God." Well, all I could say was, "May it be done unto me as you have said." Well, when I looked up, the visitor was gone. And it was a while before my mind stopped churning with Gabriel's confrontation. But when it did, I thought immediately of Joseph. Joseph, my friend, my fiancé. Oh, Joseph. As his face rose like a ghost in a smoky mirror of my mind. How will you ever understand? I told Joseph, and he did not understand. Worse, he didn't believe me. Angels? Mary? Please, no angels. Angels are the stuff of dreams, and they never show up in Nazareth except in rabbi's sermons. Joseph, my needy carpenter, was a practical man. He drove solid pegs into solid boards, and he saw my pregnancy as evidence that I'd been unfaithful. His struggling heart became a battlefield of love and logic, and I've never seen a man so broken. And his brokenness contributed to my pain, and I was torn of soul when he told me that he would break our engagement. But it was at this time that my good and kind Joseph was going to have a visitor of his own. One of those angels that he had taken such a stand against left Rabbi's sermon and came to him, saying, "Joseph, you son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for she shall have a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, and he shall save his people from their sins." Joseph returned to me a broken man, and he gave me back his promise of unending love, a humble feast served upon the table of his soul. If contrition is the bread of lovers, we devoured the loaf. Well, in passing months, there came an emperor-wide enrollment. It was tax time throughout Augustus' world. We were required by Augustus' law to make the pilgrimage to Joseph's ancestral home in Bethlehem. The Romans would not allow for any excuses. All must make the journey. All must be enrolled. All. No matter that I was in the last weeks of my pregnancy, the journey must be made. I was glad that God had given me that carpenter named Joseph. Joseph seemed so strong and robust with his hands that swung a hammer and an axe and yet could gently reach to touch my shoulder. It pains me to admit that I complained. "I cannot make this trip. Our baby is too near, Joseph. I cannot." "Mary, I will be with you. And God goes just ahead of us." Joseph was so kind. "He will be faithful, even as the prophet said. He will bear you up on eagle's wings. Do you suppose that he would ask you to be the mother of God's son and not protect and guard that son, Mary?" And so we went, my carpenter philosopher, my carpenter protector, and myself. I knew that Joseph was right. We had a date with God in Bethlehem. In fact, all the world had a date with God in Bethlehem, and that date could not be postponed. Augustus himself played the role in this event, and he never knew that he served the living God. Well, the Judean roads were crowded. The inns were always full. And as we drew near Bethlehem, I began to feel the pain of childbirth settling down upon me. And Joseph could tell I was uncomfortable and knew our son would soon be born. And we hurried into that unfriendly place. And he knocked on every door in that city in an attempt to find us a room. But alas, the city was so thronged by others who had to pay their taxes that there just wasn't any room available. Only one innkeeper, learning of my condition, offered us any help at all. And the most that he could do was to offer a stable cave. It seemed so ungracious from him, and yet how grateful we were for that little space out of the cold night air. And it had not been very long when Jesus came, and at last the pain stopped, and generously, like the first warm rain of spring, joy just came. It just overwhelming. I enthralled in the joy. We were totally oblivious to everything else. We could not know that outside the town, the sky split open with angels, and they announced to a group of shepherds with terrifying volume that the three of us were in this stable cave. The Savior had been born. And they came, those rustic men, staring at the baby I held. Their glaze became transfixed. Then they seemed to be on such an odd compulsion to obey some distant mandate which they barely understood. Not knowing exactly what to do, they fidgeted awkward and then began falling one by one on their knees, casting their eyes momentarily away from Jesus as though what they saw was too holy to look upon. Tears fell unashamed across their sun-baked faces as though the child was theirs. This was a look that I would get used to in time. But now, was the baby mine or not? I thought so. And yet, if you could have seen their faces, you would have thought the child was theirs. These rustic field hands were the first to teach me that this boy I held belonged to all. The shepherd's adoration had an oddly quieting effect upon me. I could see that in their own uncomplicated way, these simple men understood the importance of the night. They said their celebration was the subject of the whole sky of angels singing grand hallelujahs. "Pshaw, my lady," said one of the shepherds. "We ain't in seeing them angels afore, and I've been a-reckon the whole way into town. Why, angels appear to a polecat bunch of herders like ourselves." "It's grace," I told them, "all of grace. See, God comes to all of us with gifts too immense for us to understand." I laughed, though, when one of the men told me that the angels loudly ordered them not to be afraid. 'Twere a little late for saying that. I looked down at my new baby boy. We all did. Jesus was sleeping soundly. A second time, the shepherds gazed upon my child and once again bowed down, and then they shuffled out quietly into the night. You know, it takes a while for new parents to learn to wear the word, but in those rare moments when I was leaving off thinking about Jesus being the Son of God, I enjoyed thinking about him being the son of me and Joseph. We were, after all, a real family. One mother, one father, one child. And families do not use grand words when they speak to each other. And I was discovering that being a mommy held a special warmth, that it was always transcended into the notion of being some kind of holy vessel. And Joseph was simply, yet wonderfully, daddy. Daddy. He felt the way I did. Even in those first few days after Jesus was born, I could see him thinking to himself, as all daddies must, I'm going to make a carpenter out of Jesus, whom we will call little Josh. One night, he was rocking Jesus right after his midnight feeding, and I overheard him say, "Go to sleep, my little Josh. You got to get your rest if you're going to learn to use a hammer and a saw." The statement seemed almost natural to him. He had every daddy's dream of wanting his son to be like himself. But what I found most difficult was trying to fit together the fact that the angel had called him the Son of the Most High, while Joseph called him little Josh, infant messiahs, maybe princes in heaven, but they remain simply babies. Well, once the enrollment was over, we left the cave. Our housing became more available, and I was glad that we found another home, for life seemed to return to normal once Joseph began working again. However, it was on the eighth day of Jesus' life we went to present him to the temple, and an odd and beautiful thing happened. There was an old man named Simeon who had lived off for most of the country. And he was well known in the city, especially by those who frequented the temple. He was generally believed that God was keeping the old man alive if for such a time as the Messiah would come to Israel. He was, by all popular consent, the one who would identify the Messiah when he came. Most people thought he would point out some robust and winsome young zealot who could levy the large German armies and teach the Romans a thing or two. But Simeon was so schooled in the ways of God that he was able to spot God's son even when he came wrapped in swaddling clothes. As easy if he could have seen the Messiah come astride a steed. I will never forget this wonderful eighth day of Jesus' life. I was leaning on Joseph, still a little weak from having given birth. And as we walked up to the temple, this fearsome old man approached us like a thundering prophet. And when he reached out to take our baby, I was paralyzed by fear. I certainly didn't want any stranger touching my little Jesus. And I drew away from Simeon, fiercely protective. But somehow, my motherly instincts were put to rest. I still can't believe what I did next. I willingly extended my little bundled boy to that old man. And light washed down across his leathery face, and he stopped. And he held the baby. And tears filled like liquid light on the baby's blanket. And he stared, and he smiled, and he wept. As a large crowd started gathering around us, and I looked, and his smile broadened even further, and he held Jesus towards heaven, and through the entire sky was God's blue altar, and he cried, "Behold!" His opaque eyelids were glazed with brightness as he half shouted to the heavens and half shouted to those around us, "Now let me depart in peace, for my eyes have seen the salvation of God." Suddenly, all things were wrapped in joy. The Messiah was on the earth. Simeon had confirmed it. Simeon reminded me that Joseph and I could never nearly just be a family. We were somehow actors in a pageant so big that God could only have written it. We were like performers in a Roman drama acting out cosmic truths in a dingy little theater of human hope. And a strange and wonderful old man was holding my baby. And Simeon, like the shepherds, reminded me again that Jesus wasn't only my baby. He belonged to a family bigger than mine. And Simeon was telling a truth bigger than my truth. Simeon handed Jesus back to me and turned and walked away. Other things laid ahead. In time, kings from the east would come, bringing us treasures that would make our brief exile to Egypt possible. Herod would send his soldiers to massacre the children. Oh, the future was all joy and apprehension, mingled in a single chalice of saving love. But for now, I had a baby. And even as his little hands reached to touch my hair and pat my face, I knew God's only son, his beloved son, was in my arms as surely as God himself was in the world.
Amen. Amen. You'll never know a love like this. That God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, Jesus, because he loves you. Unto us a Savior is born. Came to the city of David. His name is Jesus. I saw something this week that just really puzzled me and moved my heart. There was a car. And on the car, this man wrote on his car, "I'm dying, I need a kidney. Does your blood type match mine?" And he put his blood type. I thought about the desperation of this man. He has no family, no friends that can help him. He's just saying, "I'm dying, I need a kidney." And then he showed his blood type. A lot of you are dying. A lot of people are dying. They can't bear the guilt, the shame, of the choices we've all made, but there's one choice today that you can make. It's the greatest choice of your life. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord Jesus. It doesn't matter where you're at or what you've done. It's a whosoever. It's an open offer of amazing grace, how sweet the sound. And God's offering it to you today. Well, Pastor, you don't know what I've done. I don't need to know what you've done. I know what Christ has done. God has come to the earth to save you. The greatest time in history was when the Messiah came for everybody. You can understand the Jewish mind at this time. They were sick and tired of being under the rule of the Romans. They thought they needed deliverance and liberation from an army. But the real deliberation and deliverance is for our hearts and our guilt and our shame. You can have the biggest house, the nicest car. That won't bring the peace. It's when you're forgiven. And God was on a rescue mission. And that's why he sent his son Jesus for me and for you. So we can be free and full of faith before God because of Jesus. My middle son was a little boy. He was about 5 years old, and he decided to climb a tree. He was a real climber. He'd sneak out of the house at 5 a.m. and just wander through the neighborhood. He was kind of an odd kid. All of us have had those kind of kids. And he climbed this tree, and he went so high. I looked. I said, "Where is my son?" And I began to call out his name over and over. And I looked up in this tree, and he said, "Hi, Dad. I'm up here, but I can't get down." Well, the tree was too thin for me to climb it. It couldn't hold my weight. And I thought to myself, how did this kid, I know that all of these genetics didn't come from me. What was he thinking to go up this tree and now he can't get down? And time was going on, and I knew the little boy was growing weak. I looked at my eldest son. I said, "Go get him. Go get him." My son, eldest son, climbed that tree and told his little brother, "Take my hand. I got you. We'll get you down." Well, the little boy had to reach out, which he did. He said, "Thanks a lot for saving me." They came down the tree. We all kind of laughed and celebrated. And I didn't tell his mama, because she wouldn't have celebrated over this. I told her later, not right afterwards. And I looked at my son and I said, "Why did you climb the tree?" He said, "Just because it was there." All of us have some genetic kids. You know what I'm talking about. Where did these genetics come from? And a big grin on his face, and here's what he said. "My big brother saved me. He went up the tree and brought me down." It's a metaphor. And it's apropos that God himself sent his son to come after you. But you've got to reach out. You've got to reach out right now. You've got to acknowledge before God you've done some things that are wrong, that your life hasn't gone the way it should go. It could have went, but that can change today. You see, when God sent his son, it was a rescue mission for people who are up trees in trouble. You know, we never imagined we'd live in a history like this. The economy and the fear on people hasn't been this bad for 70 years since World War II. It is a serious, serious time. And people are lonely. People are afraid. People are isolated. But look at glad tidings is here right now with the word of the Lord for you. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord Jesus will be saved. That's you. Sir, that's you. Your retirement, your job, all the things you've leaned on in life aren't that certain. There are hundreds and thousands of people without jobs. There's governments collapsing. The financial confusion on the earth. They're talking about another wave. When is it going to end? I believe right now that God is bringing people to the greatest moment of their life. That's the moment where God sent his son. And now you have opportunity. There's no excuses. Whosoever, open invitation, great, small, rich, and poor, doesn't matter what your background is, the Savior has come, and now you can respond. He's standing at the door of your heart and knocking. And it says this, "I'm knocking. If you'll open your heart to me today, I'll come in and fellowship with you. I'll forgive you of all your sins, and you'll become mine. And someday you'll go to heaven. And on earth, you get to walk with the Savior right now. Pastor Schott, I know you're right. This and that, all of these excuses, all these rabbit trails, all these years, I'm ready right now. I want you to pray after me in faith. Say it out loud with your mouth and mean it. Lord Jesus, I am a sinner. Oh, but you're the Savior. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of all my sins. Thank you that you love me. Lord, I'm truly sorry for what I've done, but I accept what you've done. And from this day forward, I'm going to follow you. You're going to be my Lord and King. God, my desire is to please you from now on. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiving me. Thank you, Jesus, for being my Lord and Savior. Thank you, Jesus. You were sent. You're the Savior. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to wish all of you a Merry Christmas. We've come to Canada from an assignment from the Lord. I want to thank my wife today for a beautiful presentation through the eyes of Mary. Sweetheart, you did a great job. Merry Christmas. You're the love of my life. It's an honor to be here. We have met the most wonderful, sincere, competent, capable people at Glad Tidings Church. We're excited because a chapter is going to change. I'm telling you, it's going to change. It won't be like this forever. Somebody grab a hold of faith right now and believe God. It's just a little season, but this season is going to change. Hallelujah. Glory to God. This coming Thursday night, you don't want to miss it. We're very aware of your family time, but 30 minutes for God from 6 o'clock to 6:30, we're going to have a very unique Christmas Eve service. You will not want to miss it. I'll just say this to you. It's nice. Like, hey, what is wrong with you if you miss this from 6 to 6:30? I want you to prepare. We're going to have a Christmas Eve communion. Pastor Jody Ann and I are going to lead it, and I want you to get your bread, your grape juice, and let's have communion together. We'll take 30 minutes, call a timeout. Some of you are going to gain too much weight anyway. You need to call 30 minutes, say, we're not eating for 30 minutes. Just settle everything down, come together as a family. And every Wednesday night, remember, we're still going to have service Wednesday night, Sunday. But this Thursday night at 6 o'clock to 6:30, we're going to have a special Christmas Eve service together. I'm excited about it, aren't you? Well, thank you for allowing us during this very, very volatile time to be your pastor. We consider it a privilege and an honor. We wondered why we had years where we suffered, where it was difficult. You know what? Now I know. I know that God made me, designed me for this day, declare to you, we're not going to make it. We're going to really make it. This house is going to be full of glory, salvation, people filled with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I want to make a declaration. This is a house of praise and worship. Put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. I will bless the Lord. His praises will be in my mouth. God's going to fill this place with supernatural glory in every tribe, every tongue, every nation is going to come to Glad Tidings Church. Let me just tell you the address where the revival has already started inside of us. 3456 Fraser Street. Wake up, somebody. God is moving in a supernatural way. This is not a time for leaders to be full of fear, unbelief, double-minded. Don't worry, preacher, about your retirement and your parking spot. Worry about having a fresh word from heaven for the people of God, because the bread of heaven still comes from the pulpit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Merry Christmas. Once again, I want to thank Pastor Jody Ann. Let me just take a moment and thank many, many people. Josh, you have done a tremendous job leading. Being is a real gift to all of us. They have really given us great, great leadership during this time. So this live broadcast can come right to you. I want to thank those two men for what they've done. And I'm telling you, Nicole, you are tremendous. We are so proud of you. We've been able to bless many families, many people. Single moms, we tell you, you're not alone. Glad Tidings is here. We love you. Hallelujah. You belong to God, and He's going to make a way beyond your wildest dreams. Also, Jerome has been a tremendous gift to me personally, and he's brought a spirit of worship in the house. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There's singers, and then there's worshipers. There's performers, and then there's praisers. There's a big difference, and this house is a house of praise and worship. Our team's going to close in a song. I want to pray right now by faith. Father, thank you. We declare peace in the hearts of your people and in their homes. The Prince of Peace be the centerpiece of your life. Jesus, we declare the latter glory will be greater than the former. Thank you for setting us up for heaven's invasion. In Jesus' mighty name.